evening. We're glad you made the time to be here tonight, where we are thinking about the passion, the suffering of our Lord Jesus Christ on our behalf. Maundy Thursday recalls the evening before the crucifixion when Jesus and the apostles ate together in the upper room and observed what we call today the Lord's Supper. And at the end of the meal, Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper or communion. The word Maundy comes from a Latin word which means command, referring to Jesus' command that we follow his example and wash one another's feet. And we sometimes call this a tenebrae service. Tenebrae is also another Latin word that refers to the onset of darkness. And at the end of the service, we will leave here, as many of you know, in complete darkness. You'll notice there's one dark candle over here on the candelabra. That's the Judas candle. And then the other white candles are for the other 11 apostles. And you've also got two thief candles on this table behind the communion table. And then the white candle is the Christ candle. And this service helps us to remember, maybe to re-enter a little bit, to recall, and to some degree experience the horrible darkness of Christ's passion when he took upon himself your sins and my sins. He took upon himself the sins of the whole world. He was betrayed and forsaken and then faced alone the terrible wrath of God. And he did so on our behalf because he wanted to save us, because he loves us so very much. Now, I want to make a couple brief comments about the offering we'll be taking up. We're doing this year what we've done for a number of years now, is our offering will be split between Seneca Hills Bible Camp and Pine Valley Bible Camp, two ministries that we've supported for a long time. We ask that you use the Easter envelope in the pew rack in front of you, or else the one provided in your own envelope box. Use that to direct your offering. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we think of this most somber of occasions where Jesus is betrayed. Jesus begins to feel the sins of the world, our sins coming upon himself as he will go to the cross as our substitute. We pray, Father, we will in a sense re-enter in that and recall that together as we look forward to the crucifixion and then pass that to the resurrection, where we know we're accepted by you. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
When I first learned to read, I first learned to do one thing right after that, and that was hate reading. For some reason, I just wanted to be outside running around, riding on my bike, until I was in second grade. And I think it was because my mom never gave up, and she kept bringing books for me to read that she found from the school library or from our public library. And then I started loving reading, because she brought home adventures. There was buried treasure involved. There were people overcoming obstacles and problems, and I loved them. And the best part about all the stories was that there was a nice, clean resolution at the end. All the problems went away, the treasure was found, everyone lived happily ever after, and there's something deep within inside me still to this day that that's what I long for. It still bothers me for some reason if I watch something or see the messiness of life, and things are just not the way that they're supposed to be. And so tonight, we're here to commemorate what Jesus did to resolve the conflict that we had with God and to guarantee us that we have a happy ending if we place our trust in him. And it's by viewing tonight within the context of everything that God was doing throughout the story of the Bible that we can really grow to appreciate the gravity and the grace of what God was doing tonight. God's plan, if you go way back to the beginning, begins in the book of Genesis, and God created humans to enjoy an intimate relationship with him, and also to be blessed by his goodness and by his generosity. And so God placed Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden and told them, be fruitful and multiply. Take care of the garden and rule righteously over everything that is in the world that I have given you. There's only one thing you shouldn't do. Do not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. It says, for in that day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. So God gave them a deal. He made a covenant with them that said, if you obey, you will have blessings and you will have life. If you disobey, you will fall under punishment and you will experience death. So as we know, Adam and Eve ate the fruit. And with this act of treason, they didn't just disobey God, but they put themselves in the place of God. They rejected God, they rejected his authority in their lives. And that opened a fissure between God and humanity, destroying the communion that we once enjoyed in Adam and Eve with God. We were God's children, but we became children of wrath. We were in God's love, but now we were under his judgment as humanity. But God extends the promise of salvation for humanity along with his patience and love. Adam and Eve, of course, are cursed, and their relationships that they're going to have in their life suddenly becomes very difficult. Whether it's working or procreating and giving birth or any other part, it's now more difficult and more painful than it was ever meant to be. And also the serpent is cursed. God curses the serpent, and this is also where God offers hope and mercy to humanity. God says to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and above all beasts of the field. On your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." God promises that he will provide deliverance through a human, through the offspring of Eve. And sin continues to grow in the story of the Bible. Noah, in the time of Noah, sin gets worse and worse. Despite God's promise of salvation, sin starts to overtake everything. So God tells Noah, "I am going to release my judgment upon the earth." He tells Noah, "Build an ark. I will save you because you are righteous, and I will spare humanity and animals through what you are going to do." And then God tells him, after all this is done, he says, "I will never, ever destroy the earth again with water." And although this act doesn't save us from sin, it does assure us that God is not done with humanity. And at some point, he will deliver on the promise of a Savior. Centuries later, Abram comes up in the story. God calls him out of his homeland in order to make him a man of faith and a father of a great nation. Not great in the sense of having lots of offspring, though he will have many offspring, but also great because the Savior of humanity will come through his offspring. And through Abraham and his descendants, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph, God created the nation of Israel, his people who would be his light in a world filled with darkness. And through these people, the world would be offered salvation. God goes on to formalize his people through making a covenant with Moses. He takes his people out of Egypt, delivers them, rescues them, takes them to the desert, and then there he makes a covenant with them when they are all by themselves and it's just them and God. The covenant reminds them of what was going on with Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. He tells them, "If you obey my laws that I'm giving you, you will have blessing. If you disobey, then once again, you will fall under judgment." They, of course, rebelled and failed. But God gave them grace through the laws that govern their religious ceremonies, their civil ceremonies, the social life, everything. God gave them a means by which justice and mercy could thrive within the group of them. The religious rules gave them a structure for worshiping God that also pointed to the coming deliverance, the promise of a Savior. They were reminded regularly that the law that they needed, through the law, that they needed redemption and that deliverance, and that the only way that would come was through a sacrifice. So while the rest of the world is stewing in its sin, becoming more and more sinful, doing whatever they feel like, God is still grooming his people. Over and over again, they worship other gods. God calls them to repent, and they repent and come back to him. And during this repeating cycle, God makes yet another covenant with King David, a promise that builds on the promise that he made to Adam and Eve. It says, God said to David, "When your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever." The deliverer would come through the line of David, and not only that, he would be a king. And after David, God would raise up prophets. They would warn the people of judgment for their sin and for their disobedience. The prophets would encourage them to repent, to turn back to God. And the prophets would point to a future Savior who would finally come and once and for all rescue them from sin and redeem his people. It's no surprise that Isaiah also builds on the promises that God made to Eve and David. Isaiah wrote, "Who has believed what he has heard from us, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." Isaiah gives an even clearer picture. God provides the picture through Isaiah. There's going to be a human deliverer. He's going to be a king. He'll be one of God's people. He will not appear to be special in any way. His own people will reject him. He will be crushed for sins that he didn't commit. His sacrifice will save others and make others righteous. Not just others, but make sinners righteous. And then Jesus is born to Mary. Jesus grows. He begins teaching scripture. And in John chapter 5, he says, "You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life, and it is they that bear witness about me." He is the one who was promised. And in Luke 24, after the resurrection, he appears to the disciples and says, "And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself." All of scripture had been pointing to Jesus coming. Jesus, the Son of God, came to take away our sins, to fulfill all righteousness, to establish a kingdom, to conquer the devil. And through a life of perfect obedience, Jesus was able to fulfill God's perfect, righteous, God's demand for a perfect and righteous life. Tonight, we remember that the penalty for sin was paid, not symbolically, like in the Old Testament sacrifices, but in reality by the death of God's Son, Jesus, the one who is the long-promised deliverer of humanity. Through the death of Jesus, God solves the problem of needing justice and punishment for all of our sins. Through the cross, God can forgive us, he can rescue us from the devil, and he can make us his children. And on Easter morning, in a couple days, we will celebrate the resurrection, the empty tomb, and that God kept his promise. And we will hope for our bodily resurrection and the perfect, complete, happy ending of us being glorified and dwelling in the presence of God forever. We will rejoice with song. We will celebrate with all sorts of different food and candy. But tonight, on Maundy Thursday, tonight reminds me a bit of my friend Nate, who has been battling leukemia. He's been growing weaker and weaker. I get updates. The last time that I had talked to him when he really had all of the strength was around Thanksgiving. We met at Grove City. We were in the same year, and he came to Grove City, which is a Christian school, as a very argumentative atheist, and very, very brilliant at that. And so there was all sorts of good intentioned students who would try to evangelize and point out the error of his ways, and he was able to walk circles around them because he had already read all of those things and the counter-arguments, and he drove people crazy. He was a really funny guy in college. And so he and I pledged our fraternity together our junior year, which just basically means that we stayed up and didn't sleep for a week and then had to do all sorts of stupid things. And so by the end of the week, we were delirious, and we had spent the entire week in each other's rooms either hiding out or trying to get work done or anything like that. And I remember we just wanted to go to sleep, but we knew that we couldn't. And we were just talking about life. And I looked at him and I said, "You know, we have so many things in common. We've spent so many years together. I wish that we could share Jesus, that you would be my Christian brother." I said, "That would be amazing." And then he looked at me and said, "Oh yeah, I did that over the summer." I said, "What? You didn't tell me?" And so we laughed about that for a while. But I talked to him around Thanksgiving of this past year, and he said that he didn't really understand what it meant to believe and to trust in Christ until he had been battling leukemia for the past, I think it's almost 2.5 years at this point. And so he had been battling, and things had been getting worse and worse, and he was in the ER all the time. And he just mentioned that all the suffering solidified his faith. And I wanted to come here tonight and talk about how bittersweet it was that he would suffer all of those things and that he would still have his faith be growing through all of that. But really tonight, it's bittersweet for me, excuse me, because this afternoon I learned that he had already passed away. I know that today he is with Jesus in paradise, and there's much to celebrate for that, but I'm going to miss him. And tonight's service has that same sort of bittersweet sentiment to it. On one hand, we have the sweetness of knowing that our sins are forgiven, that Jesus loved us enough to willingly offer himself for us, and to know that we are no longer under God's judgment because of what we're going to hear about tonight. But there is bitterness knowing that I'm the reason, and we are all the reason, that Jesus had to suffer, knowing that the blood and the torture and the beating is what I deserved, but Jesus took it for me. And every year, I can hear my own voice when the criminal is mocking Jesus. But as we leave here tonight, we're going to cling to the cross. We cling to Jesus Christ crucified, and hope, and our hope is in the sacrifice and the resurrection that we will celebrate on Easter morning. That just as Jesus was raised from the dead, when our time comes, that we will be raised into glory with Jesus Christ. Amen.
On reaching Jerusalem, Jesus entered the temple area and began driving out those who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves, and would not allow anyone to carry merchandise through the temple courts. And as he taught them, he said, "Is it not written, 'My house will be called a house of prayer for all nations,' but you have made it a den of robbers?" The chief priests and the teachers of the law heard this and began looking for a way to kill him, for they feared him because the whole crowd was amazed at his teaching. Jesus replied, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. I tell you the truth, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. The man who loves his life will lose it, while the man who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. Now my heart is troubled, and what shall I say? 'Father, save me from this hour?' No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it and will glorify it again." Then Jesus told them, "You're going to have the light just a little while longer. Walk while you have the light before darkness overtakes you. The man who walks in the dark does not know where he is going. Put your trust in the light while you have it, so that you may become sons of light." When he had finished speaking, Jesus left and hid himself from them.
Then one of the 12, the one called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priest and asked, "What are you willing to give me if I hand him over to you?" So they counted out for him 30 silver coins. From then on, Judas watched for an opportunity to hand him over. After he had said this, Jesus was troubled in spirit and testified, "I tell you the truth, one of you is going to betray me." His disciples stared at one another, at a loss to know which of them he meant. One of them, the disciples whom Jesus loved, was reclining next to him. Simon Peter motioned to this disciple and said, "Ask him which one he means." Leaning back against Jesus, he asked him, "Lord, who is it?" Jesus answered, "It is the one to whom I will give this piece of bread when I have dipped it in this dish." Then, dipping the piece of bread, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, son of Simon. As soon as Judas took the bread, Satan entered into him. "What you're about to do, do quickly," Jesus told him. But no one at the meal understood why Jesus said this to him. Since Judas had charge of money, some thought Jesus was telling him to buy what was needed for the feast, or to give something to the poor. As soon as Judas had taken the bread, He went out, and it was night. Then Jesus went to his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him. And he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Could you men not keep watch with me for 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is weak." He went away a second time and prayed, "My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done." When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour is near, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let's go. Here comes my betrayer." While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. "The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him." Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus replied, "Friend, do what you came for." Then the men stepped forward, seized Jesus, and arrest him. With that, one of Jesus' companions reached for his sword, drew it out, and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. "Put your sword back in its place," Jesus said to him, "for all who draw the sword will die by the sword. Do you think I cannot call on my Father, and he at will once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen in this way?" At that time, Jesus said to the crowd, "Am I leading a rebellion that you have come out with swords and clubs to capture me? Every day I sat in a temple courts teaching, and you did not arrest me. But this is all taken place that the writings of the prophets might be fulfilled." Then all the disciples deserted him and fled.
They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, elders, and teachers of the law came together. Then some stood up and gave false testimony against him. "We heard him say, 'I will destroy this man-made temple, and in 3 days will build another, not made by man.'" Yet even then, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus, "Are you not going to answer? What is this testimony that these men are bringing against you?" But Jesus remained silent and gave no answer. Again, the high priest asked him, "Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?" "I am," said Jesus, "and you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven." The high priest tore his clothes. "Why do we need any more witnesses?" he asked. "You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?" They all condemned him as worthy of death. Then some began to spit at him. They blindfolded him, struck him with their fists, and said, "Prophesy." And the guards took him and beat him. Very early in the morning, the chief priests with the elders, the teachers of the law, and the whole Sanhedrin reached a decision. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. "Are you the king of the Jews?" asked Pilate. "Yes, it is as you say," Jesus replied. The chief priests accused him of many things. So again, Pilate asked him, "Aren't you going to answer? See how many things they're accusing you of." But Jesus still made no reply, and Pilate was amazed. When he learned that Jesus was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem at that time. When Herod saw Jesus coming, he was greatly pleased, because for a long time he had been wanting to see him. From what he had heard about him, he hoped to see him perform some miracle. He plied him with many questions, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and the teachers of the law were standing there, vehemently accusing him. Then Herod and his soldiers ridiculed and mocked him. Dressing him in an elegant robe, they sent him back to Pilate.
While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she looked closely at him. "You also were with Nazarene Jesus," she said, but he denied it. "I don't know or understand what you're talking about," he said, and he went out into the entryway. When the servant girl saw him there, she said again to those standing around, "This fellow is one of them." Again, he denied it. After a little while, those standing near said to Peter, "Surely you are one of them, for you are a Galilean." He began to call down curses on himself, and he swore to them, "I don't know this man that you're talking about." Immediately, the rooster crowed the second time. Then Peter remembered the words Jesus had spoken to him, "Before the rooster crows twice, you will disown me three times." And he broke down and wept.
Pilate called together the chief priests, the rulers, and the people, and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was inciting the people to rebellion. I have examined him in your presence and have found no basis for your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us. As you can see, he has done nothing to deserve death. Therefore, I will punish him and then release him." With one voice, they cried out, "Away with this man! Release Barabbas to us!" Barabbas had been thrown into prison for an insurrection in the city and for murder. Wanting to release Jesus, Pilate appealed to them again, but they kept shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" For the third time, he spoke to them, "Why? What crime has this man committed? I have found in him no grounds for the death penalty. Therefore, I will have him punished and then release him." But with loud shouts, they insistently demanded that he be crucified, and their shouts prevailed. So Pilate decided to grant their demand. He released the man who had been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder, the one they asked for, and surrendered Jesus to their will.
Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him, "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we are getting our deeds deserved. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise."
When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, this disciple took her into his home. Later, knowing that all was now completed, and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of a hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. From the sixth hour until the ninth hour, darkness came over all the land. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed his last. The centurion, seeing what had happened, praised God and said, "Surely this was a righteous man." When all the people who had gathered to witness this sight saw what took place, they beat their breasts and they went away.